So essentially, flat foot is a condition that we see a lot of times. It's also known as pes planus, and we see it in children, we see it in adults, we see it in patients who have a loss of medial longitudinal arch, and it can be stiff or supple. But for the sake of this particular talk, I'm just going to concentrate on the posterior tibial tendon dysfunction. So now, in order to understand this condition a bit better, one has to go back to the anatomy. So the anatomy of this tendon is complex. It is formed in the back of the leg, and it is a very long tendon. It starts almost at the level of the medial malleolus behind the tibia, and it has a long muscular attachment proximally as well. The tendon comes down behind the medial malleolus under the flexor retinaculum in a sheath and then gets attached into the navicular bone. And then it also has slips to the other bones in the mid-tarsal area. The problem though is that it runs at a very sharp angle just behind the medial malleolus there, where it can cause problems. Although it is encased in a synovial sheath and it's thoroughly nourished by the synovial fluid, one has to consider that the sharp angle can be a potentially hypovascular area. It does work as a plantar flexor of the foot, but it also works as inverter of the foot. It has a function of the support of the medial arch, and especially in the foot push-off phase, it locks the midfoot, and hence it's very important in the gait cycle. So essentially, it's still a chicken and egg situation. What came first? Whether it was the tendon dysfunction that led to spring ligament failure, or is it the spring ligament damage that led to posterior tibial tendon dysfunction? There are a lot of studies going on, a lot of cadaveric studies going on, and I think it is important to understand that both play an important role. So in the foot, we have static stabilizers and dynamic stabilizers. One of the important structure of the foot is the bony anatomy, and that leads to intrinsic stability in various joints in the foot. The medial and lateral side of the bony anatomy provides a good structure to the bone, and that has been subsequently supported by the dynamic stabilizers. The dynamic stabilizers are the muscles and the tendons in the foot. They can be both intrinsic or extrinsic. And essentially, I think it's important to notice that the posterior tibial tendon is the one which takes control of most of the midfoot region. As I mentioned before, it has insertion in all tarsal bones except talus. In addition to that, there is flexor digitorum longus, flexor hallucis longus, tibant, peroneus, and abductor hallucis as well, supporting this area. The posterior tibial tendon is mainly inserted on the navicular, but it also appears to be seen on to the other parts of the midfoot bones. And the triceps suri is important in maintaining the position of the calcaneus in a neutral position. As in flat foot deformity, this muscle turns to feel and work in the form of valgus deforming force. And later on, the heel goes into valgus. So why do we get this condition? So the condition can be seen due to hypovascularity, like I mentioned before, and that is the area where the tendon ruptures, or it leads to some micro tears initially, and then even a simple small tear can turn into a complete tear with some traumatic etiology. The recurrent inflammation and micro tears within the tendon can cause further inflammation and pain. In addition to that, the spring ligament, which is one of the most important ligament in this region, which is the calcaneonavicular ligament, then fails. Any length of the posterior tibial tendon, mainly lengthening, can affect and stretching of the tendon, even by a centimeter, can lead to severe malfunction. So we see various causes of this condition. I get to see inflammatory causes, such as in rheumatoid patients. I see in traumatic conditions, especially in younger patients. Degenerative is very common in women over the age of 55, especially those patients who have comorbidities such as diabetes, hypertension, rheumatoid arthritis, patients who are on steroids, and sometimes even after the injections that are done into the tendinous areas. So how do these patients present? These patients present with medial arch pain and ankle pain. They will have swelling initially on the medial aspect of the ankle, with loss of medial arch and pain on the lateral side later on in the cycle with the impingement of calcaneofibular area. They will also report rapid shoe wear, and they may also have other joint deformities in the later stages. How do we clinically assess them? Now, this is important from the FRCS patient perspective. The candidates who are appearing for the exam will be shown this case quite often. This is a very common condition seen in the UK and elsewhere, and there will be plenty of patients in the exam. So essentially, all examination is done as look, feel, move, and special tests, as like any other joints. So when we look at these patients, we look at them standing and sitting, we look at their gait, and we see the deformity from all three and four directions. So we'll see the flat foot deformity on the medial side as depicted here, but looking from the back, you will also see the valgus of the heel, the so-called too many toes sign, where you will see more toes on the lateral aspect of the foot, and then they will show some supination of the forefoot along with tiptoe sign, which I'll come back to a bit later. In the feel and move section, one has to see the area of the tenderness, which can be bony tenderness as well as soft tissue tenderness. The tendon itself will be tender. There will be tenderness laterally in the sinus tarsi later on. And there will be bony deformity, which one has to see whether it's stiff or supple. So in other words, the range of motion needs to be checked in the subtalar joint, in the metatarsal joint, as well as in the ankle joint, and see which joints are stiff and which ones are supple. Coming on to the special test, this is the most important test that we examine, and this is the tiptoe test, also known as Jack's test. The Jack test shows that when the patient is asked to stand on the tiptoes, there is correction of the heel into varus. In addition to that, they will also have formation of the medial arch, and there will be external rotation of the tibia. So if a patient is asked to stand tiptoes on both feet initially, it is more than likely they'll be able to do it. But if they are asked to do it in a single stance, then they may struggle with this. And it is generally important to test it two or three times. And generally the patient gets tired after the second attempt. And if this is the case, then look for correction of the hind foot. If the hind foot is not getting corrected back into varus deformity, like in this picture, the left side corrects into varus and hence it's a flexible deformity. But on the right side, it does not correct. And it is a valgus heel deformity still. It is not on the same patient, obviously, but the picture is to try and depict the fact that the valgus does not correct. Going on to the imaging to confirm the diagnosis, we like to do plain standing x-rays with both feet and ankles, ultrasound, which is user dependent, and some of my colleagues and myself have trained ourselves to do some basic ultrasound, which can be done in the clinic, but more importantly, it is to be confirmed by the radiologist. And it also is important to get an MRI scan for difficult cases where we have to find the status of the spring ligament. The spring ligament is very well seen on the MRI scan, and Conti has developed a classification, especially on the spring ligament ruptures. So as you can see on the x-rays, the most important x-rays are AP and lateral weight-bearing x-rays. The reason to say weight-bearing is to see the exact anatomy of the bone. As you can see on the left-hand picture, there is complete flattening of the foot. But on this right-hand picture, you can see the line drawn from the talus all the way down into the first metatarsal in a straight line. Now, this is called Meary's angle. And if that angle is reversed, as in flat foot, you can see the lines do not coincide. And that just gives an indication that the foot is flat. However, it does not tell us what are the other deformities associated with it. So the classification is done by Johnson and Strom and recently modified by Mark Myerson. The stages are important in order to decide the management plan. So I will go through this, and these are important to understand clinically, and they are stage 1, 2, 3, and 4 as per the severity. Stage 1 being the most mild condition associated with tenosynovitis, but a normal length tendon. In stage 2, the tendon is elongated, it is weak, and it leads to micro tears leading to flat foot deformity, which can be subdivided, and I will come back to that later, according to the latest classification. In stage 3, the deformity is severe, and there is lateral pain due to impingement and the stiff hind foot, mainly in the subtalar joint. But in stage 4, there is deformity in ankle joint, which is usually valgus deformity, and it is classified according to Myerson description. So the treatment depends on the stage. That is why it is important to stage the condition. The associated conditions needs to be addressed, and we start always with a non-operative management. So in the non-operative section, we try with rest, non-steroidals, immobilization like air cast boot in a short-term situation, orthotics, medial arch support, and physiotherapy plays a very important role. But when the patients don't respond to physiotherapy and non-operative treatment and the condition becomes more deformed, then there are various deformities that we need to address. These include heel valgus, midfoot abduction, forefoot supination, elongation of the tendon, leading to shortening of the tendo-Achilles, and also elevation of the first ray. Associated hallux valgus deformities can also be seen with this condition, and there may be some other joint deformities such as knee deformities. So the surgical treatment, as we discussed, depends on the stage of the condition. And in stage 1, simple synovectomy and debridement of the tendon with or without repair may be sufficient. However, in stage 2, more surgical treatments are necessary in the form of bony procedures and soft tissue procedures, which we will discuss in detail. So in stage 1, we can do simple synovectomy and debridement of the tendon as seen in this picture. You can see that the tendon is exposed through a medial approach. If the tendon is inflamed without a tear, simple synovectomy is done around the medial malleolus region and towards the insertion. And if the tendon shows some tears, then it can be debrided and inserted back into the navicular tuberosity, maybe using some anchors. And if we can see the spring ligament at this point, and if it needs repair or plication, we can always do it at the same time. However, if the tendon is ruptured completely, then it is more or less stage 2, in which case we may have to consider a tendon transfer. So something like this, one can do medial approach, expose the sheath and repair the tendon or debride the tendon as and when required. Moving on to stage 2 deformity, which is more severe, but initially it still can be supple. However, later on it becomes stiff and patients are unable to stand on tiptoes. They will always have constant medial and lateral sided pain. And you can see, according to this picture, you will see a large bulge on the medial side, which causes the pain. So stage 2 is subdivided into stage 2A, and stage 2B. And in the exams, it is generally seen that patients are presented with stage 2, A or B. This is where the students can sometimes fumble because they cannot classify them. And it's essential to understand the role of midfoot abduction in this situation. In both stage 2 A and B, one will get a heel valgus deformity. But what will be more evident in stage 2 B is more of midfoot abduction, such as seen in this right-hand picture, as opposed to the left-hand picture. And that is a classification difference between stage 2 A and B, where midfoot abduction is important to be considered. And the treatment for that is later on discussed in this lecture, and hence it is important to classify them correctly. So the standard treatment for stage 2 or stage 2 A or B is calcaneal osteotomy as a bony correction, which is augmented with soft tissue correction. And we will discuss about this in details now. So as I mentioned earlier on, the heel valgus is dependent on the position of the tendo Achilles. Now, if the heel valgus becomes quite severe, the tendon becomes more lateral and it starts to pull the heel more into valgus deformity. So the idea of doing calcaneal osteotomy is to redirect the force of triceps suri back into the normal alignment, and hence medialization of the calcaneum is essential. So it is done using a lateral approach, and the osteotomy is done it is shown in this picture, and the calcaneus is slided medially, thereby realigning the osteotomy and the soft tissue pull. It can be used to fix, various techniques can be used to fix the bone. One can use screws, one can use staples. There are more newer plates now to fix this sort of thing. And there is also a possibility of doing it minimally invasive. So calcaneal osteotomy is done with a lateral approach with an oblique osteotomy shown in this picture. And the slide should be at least a centimeter long. And the tendon then gets realigned. In addition to that, one has to do a tendon transfer, which is in the form of FDL or flexidigitorum longus. Now, why use flexidigitorum and not use flexor hallucis longus? We have seen that flexidigitorum longus has got enough strength to replace the posterior tibial tendon, although it's not as strong as the posterior tibial tendon, but the morbidity taking the FDL tendon rather than FHL tendon is less. The flexor hallucis longus tendon is important in gripping the floor when we are using the big toe. And hence, if we exchange that into the posterior tibial tendon, then it can lead to some weakness in the flexion of the big toe. There are some other tendons that can be used, such as the split tibialis anterior tendon, such as done in Cobb's repair, but the outcomes are not as predictable as the FDL tendon transfer. The other question that many times is asked is whether or not we should excise the diseased posterior tibial tendon or not. And my answer to that would be yes. The pain is coming from that diseased torn tendon. Hence, once we excise that tendon, the pain goes away. So after the correction of the calcaneal osteotomy, one can see the Meary angle in this patient, which was reversed, is now restored again. And that is why it is important to do this osteotomy in medialization. There are some recent advances, though, which have changed the outcome of these conditions even more. And I have performed many of these procedures and has become my routine practice now to repair the spring ligament using internal brace. It is made by Arthrex, and to my knowledge, there is nothing else comparable to Arthrex internal brace at this stage. And the reconstruction of the spring ligament is using by this fiber tape, which can be used at the same time when we are transferring the FDL tendon. As you can see, the FDL tendon here is rerouted into the navicular by making a tunnel, and an interference screw is inserted into the bone here. And there's also an interference screw into the calcaneum, into the substanticular region, which gives the normal Y-shaped feature support as a hammock to the talonavicular joint, thereby replacing the strength lost in the spring ligament. So it is a very, very helpful technique, and we use it for almost all the patients now in addition to our normal FTL tendon transfer. So the recent reports are also confirming that medializing calcaneal osteotomy and FTL tendon transfer at 1 year, and even the intermediate results are fantastic. This is one of the latest articles from 2018 by Trinker, and that has shown this. In addition to that, return to sporting activities are also very, very good with the techniques I've just described. There are newer techniques by which we can reduce the morbidity, and this is by doing minimally invasive procedures, the advantage being faster recovery and physiotherapy with early return to normal activities. And this can be used by doing minimally invasive osteotomies off the calcaneum using simple burrs as described by minimally small incisions like this, and fixation of the calcaneum using one or two screws as described in this picture. Sometimes, like I mentioned, additional procedures are required. That is dependent on what is the deformity we need to correct in addition to the primary deformity. Like I mentioned in the beginning, if the stage 2B has got midfoot abduction, then we need to address that by doing a lateral anterior calcaneal lengthening procedure, which is also known as Evans procedure. And we'll discuss about that shortly. In addition to that, if the forefoot supination is excessive, the first metatarsal is elevated as a result of that, and we may have to give a plantar flexion deformity either at the level of cuneiform or even at the level of the first metatarsal, and this is done by medial cuneiform opening wedge osteotomy, also known as Cotton's osteotomy. Sometimes in some units, including some of my patients, we have introduced gastrocnemius slide as a routine procedure, as these patients will have tight gastrosoleus confirmed by a silver skewer test. So like I mentioned, the lateral column lengthening, which is done by this procedure, where the incision is taken on the anterior side of the calcaneum, around the front here, and at least a centimeter about a centimeter long division of osteotomy is done there, and a bone block is inserted, thereby elongating the lateral column. As the flat foot deformity is a typical bean-shaped deformity where the medial side is lengthened as opposed to the lateral side, the concept is if we elongate the lateral side, it will correct the not only the convex deformity on the lateral side, but it will also slide the midfoot back into adduction deformity, which is more or less like a normal feature of the foot. After the surgery is done, either open or minimally invasive, as you can see in this picture, we have inserted two K-wires to distract the anterior calcaneum, and a bone block is applied, and a small plate has been put across there to fix the osteotomy, and it's a very stable osteotomy indeed. Like I mentioned, the Cotton's osteotomy is done to correct the forefoot supination deformity, and this is by creation of an osteotomy dorsally, and opening wedge is put on the dorsal to plantar side, thereby producing a plantar flexion correction of the deformity of the first ray. Gastrocnemius slide is done proximally, and it is sometimes necessary to do it just behind the knee distally to the knee into the proximal part of the musculotendinous junction. And it is only done in patients who have positive silver skewer test. What happens if we don't do anything? These patients will go into automatically in stage three and stage four, leading up to more severe deformities, leading to subtalar joint involvement, as well as the ankle joint deformity. These patients will end up requiring fusions, such as subtalar fusion, triple arthrodesis, or even a tibiotalocalcaneal or TTC fusion using hindfoot nail. These procedures can still be done using open or arthroscopic technique, and it is our usual practice to do ankle fusions using arthroscopic technique, and we are also getting more experienced in the subtalar joint fusions with arthroscopic techniques as well. The postoperative care for these patients is usual standard thromboprophylaxis for 6 weeks, followed by a cast application for at least 6 weeks, which is non-weight bearing, and then followed by a boot for 6 to 8 weeks if necessary. However, we try to wean the boot off in 4 weeks after surgery, after they come out of the plaster. So in total, they may require up to 3 months of protection. Although the physiotherapy starts at 6 weeks, it is more of a active dynamic exercises rather than static done by the physio himself. So this is generally our guidelines in managing these patients. And this is very helpful slide when it comes to examination for the FRCS Orth. It gives the staging of the conditions on left-hand side, which is 1 till 4. And as you can see, it goes from conservative measures to all the severe measures of treatment, depending on what stage they are. And as you can see, important is stage 2A and B, where the normal forefoot and forefoot abduction is the important sign to be established. And if they have stage 2B, where they may have to go down the route of calcaneal osteotomy along with the cottons and gastroc slide, then one has to do that all in one go. You can make it as two-step procedure, but my experience is that if we are doing all the procedures in one go, the outcomes are much better and all the problems are addressed at the same time. So the take-home message from this presentation is that this is a common condition. It is very commonly kept in the FRCS Orth exam because there are plenty of patients. There are plenty of patients who are not in much pain. There are important considerations from a condition like this, as full deformity appreciation is necessary. And we see from the candidate's examination protocols that it is necessary to assess the foot in the whole and take into consideration the proximal joints as well. The staging is important in order to discuss the treatment options, and hence the surgery then can be quite promising and positive. If, however, it is left untreated, the outcome is painful osteoarthritis, and hence some of the patients in the exam scenario are also kept as with arthritis to see how the candidates responds to the outcomes of surgery, such as complex fusions. So thank you very much for the for your attention. I'll be happy to take any questions if you have any. Thank you very much.
Dr. Limaye, that was a brilliant presentation. Thank you so much.
Thank
you. It was short, sweet, and as well as it was comprehensive, it has covered the entire subject. And there were a couple of questions, like general questions, like, sir, what are the common scenarios in the FRC's exam with respect to this topic? Is it an X-ray, an image, or a patient?
So thank you for the question. The condition is very common in the UK or elsewhere if you're taking the exam. The examination can be a patient examination or a scenario discussion. This is usually kept as an intermediate case or even short case. If it's done as an intermediate case, then usually the patients will have some other deformities, such as knee deformity or a hip problem. So you will be asked to comment on all deformities. If it's shown as a short case, then it is a quick assessment, clinical examination, and not many a times the treatment options. But it can come in adult pathology, and I do adult pathology YVAS as well, and we discuss this quite commonly in that. We discuss this in the biomechanics section or in the basic science section as well. So unfortunately or fortunately, this is a very common condition that is seen in the exam.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you so much. The other question was what is the differential diagnosis of adult acquired flatfoot?
So you can see other patients with adult acquired flatfoot deformities in situations such as subtalar joint osteoarthritis, the so-called peroneal spastic flatfoot, which is a misnomer in all fairness. Patients with peroneal tendon dysfunctions can lead to this deformity. Patients with coalition bars, which are diagnosed later in the stage, such as talocalcaneal coalition, calcaneonavicular coalition, can also be seen as a stiff deformity. Generally, it is common that the posterior tibial tendon is the commonest cause. The etiology can be anything, but it is usually an adult acquired deformity, and that's the most common thing that's seen in the exams.
Okay, thank you. The third question is it common to have an acute presentation, like acute swelling?
Yes, that's a very good question. Now, the acute situation, I have seen it a few times, and this is mainly in younger patients. Now, there are many patients who are sports enthusiasts, and these are the ones during their running or contact sports will get damaged to the posterior tibial tendon, especially rugby players, football players, patients developing fractures around the medial malleolus can also lead to a traumatic tear within the posterior tibial tendon. I remember one case very vividly of one of my own, a young chap, 18-year-old boy, who had a fracture of the medial malleolus, which was segmental with a large fragment of the bone cutting into the tendon. And that led to an acute presentation of posterior tibial tendon dysfunction within 8 weeks. And we reported this case, and it's freely available if somebody wants to have a look through it online. Although it is one-off, it's not that common that one will just get the acute rupture of the tendon without any predisposing cause. However, it is seen in patients with other comorbidities such as rheumatoid. Early rheumatoid, younger patients can lead to a spontaneous rupture.
Okay, see, and the other fourth question was, Johnson and Strom classification is nothing but a natural history, right? You
Correct.
Go from mild ones to severe.
Correct.
So is it possible to diagnose this condition in stage one itself?
Yes.
Because most of the time we see a late presentation, right?
Correct. Like I mentioned earlier on, what mind doesn't know, eyes don't see. And unfortunately, this is still a common condition that gets missed. The importance is if somebody comes to us with medial-sided ankle pain, one of the most important thing one should look for is the tenderness on the posterior tibial tendon. And if the patient does not have a deformity, but they have a posterior tibial tendon tenderness or a spring ligament tenderness, it is more than likely that they're in stage one condition. Once they start to get a flat foot deformity, one has missed the stage one, if you like, and then they go into stage two, three, or four, thereby needing more and more surgical intervention. The common problem, though, in some situations is that we miss the stage one because patients don't feel that the pain is bad enough to see a doctor. And in that case, patients don't present early, and hence we entirely miss the stage one. But in my areas where we practice, the GPs are aware of these conditions because we do a lot of talks on these conditions. And they generally tend to pick up a stage one where we can go down and do some investigations or even start physiotherapy or strengthening program give them synovectomy in stage one, and it can be delayed. However, stage two, stage three, and stage four, as you rightly said, is natural elongation of the condition, and these patients will eventually get into those stages. I'm yet to see a patient who from stage one has not gone into stage two or three.
Okay, so what do you do for stage one? How do you treat a stage one?
So in stage one, we tend to remain mostly conservative initially with the help of physio, with the help of ultrasound therapy, with the help of support such as maybe an air cast boot, or maybe give them activity modification, anti-inflammatories, insoles, and that sort of thing. But if they still continue to have pain, there's a new thing that we are currently trialing, and we are doing it as a multicenter trial now, is the hyaluronic acid injections. The ostinal tendon injection, which is a trade name for this hyaluronic acid injection, which is combined with mannitol, can be used in this condition as opposed to steroids. My personal experience with steroids in this area is not very good because there's a risk of rupture of the tendon. On the other hand, the ostinal tendon is something that reduces the inflammatory response into the tendon sheath and the synovium, thereby improves the gliding of the tendon and hence improves the symptoms. Now, we've completed our first 20 patient study on the Achilles tendon, and we have put it for publication recently. But we are now doing it on to the posterior tibial tendon as well. However, the results are still in the early stages. I'm not going to say that is a complete cure at this stage, but I think the early results are promising. So it might be something that can be used in stage one to try and delay them going into stage two. How long for? Time will tell.
What do you think about PRP for the same? Platelet-rich plasma?
Yeah, I mean, that's a fantastic question because PRP is something that is really interesting all around the world at the minute. And we've seen the PRP being injected in patellar tendon, plantar fascia, and various other places. I was recently involved in a multicenter trial for the Achilles tendinopathy using PRP. The results are awaited at the minute. The study is complete, but the results are awaited. My personal feeling is that the outcome is not significantly different as opposed to the ostinal tendon. Having said that, we don't really know how long one will get the benefit with either of the injections. So I think it's still a bit early to say that PRP is a panacea for this condition either.
Okay. Thank you, Dr. Limaye. I think there are no more questions.
Yeah,
it's a great pleasure to host you here, and we have a fantastic lecture followed by discussion. I think this has been the best sessions.
Thank you so
much. It has been an honor to host you here. Thank you once again, and we look forward for more presentations from your side.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you very much. All the best. Yeah.
Thank you. I'll end the meeting.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.